But we continue to ask critical questions. What has happened to employment creation? What has happened to addressing the global commons around access to education, access to growth facilities? These are critical questions that the transition must also answer. But quite clearly, I was talking about inflation. The measure on inflation was aimed at stabilization. Okay, so we must also agree so that you understand where I'm coming from. The issues around addressing the economy in the transition are aimed at stabilizing the economy, because the economy was, they said, it was becoming the number one enemy of the then regime, which was the ZANU-PF regime. So they had to stabilize the economy. So they put in measures that were about stabilizing the economy, but it's not really about reconstruction, which is the next phase of economic development that Zimbabwe must go through. Now, the economic question is something that's underlying in it that I want us to understand and agree on. They call it, or it's called, Zimbabwe's re-engagement with the international community. And that's where my issue around the debt question pops in terms of the discussion for tonight. But why would the debt question be important at this particular juncture? As I said, the transition is answering to two questions, the political question and the economic question. And then I am dwelling tonight on the debt question. You may want to understand what our debt structure looks like at the moment. We have a huge component of internal debt, which is debt that was accrued by the ZANU-PF regime under the name of busting what they call sanctions, generally referred to as restrictive measures. And then we also have a huge debt that was accrued through what we think was a political campaign around purchase of tractors, purchase of, they called it, farm mechanization, and then many other things. That debt alone goes up to about 1.4 billion United States dollars. That's the official figures that they give. It could be more than that. And then the other component, which is the component that I'm dwelling on tonight, is the external debt, what we call the international community, or bilateral and multilateral creditors. There are many figures that are put to public, but the one that is commonly used is about 7 billion. United States dollars. Now, for many people who want 7 billion, there are countries that are owing so much more, there are countries that are really indebted. What is 7 billion? For us as debt campaigners and economic justice campaigners, there's a lot of money in the Zimbabwe context. Why? Because put together, it accounts for, as at 2010, when the debt keeps on growing because there is interest accruing on arrears each day of the, if each day the debt is not serviced. Now, what we have is a situation where the debt accounts for about 103% of our GDP. So by any standard, it means it's quite significant. And then we take it to be a burden, because the first point is that it is not serviceable. The second point is that we cannot actually repay it using whatever form of our mechanism that is there. Now, what is the government's position? I am not coming from that, because somebody walks in and then they hear you say, what is the government's position, and you start articulating. What I understand them to be saying is that, okay, the first point here that we all must appreciate and understand is that for the first time, I think, 32 years or so after independence, there is an attempt on the part of the government to actually address the debt question. And what they've done is they put together a document that they call Zimbabwe Accelerated Arrears Clearance Debt and Development Strategy. It was made public on the 16th of March this year. It's largely done by the Minister of Finance. Now, because the debt question is such a question that many Zimbabweans do not actively engage in, so many things can go unnoticed. and therefore Zimbabwe can move to a, what we call an undesirable state of affairs in terms of resolving the debt question, which is why we think it's important for us to be discussing it tonight. What the ZADS document basically is saying is that Zimbabwe must use what is called a hybrid strategy to resolve the debt question. What is the hybrid strategy? It involves two things. The first one is an IMF, World Bank, and African Development Bank driven process. They've done it in many other countries. It's called the Indebted Poor Countries Initiative, EPIC. Okay, so you go through a stringent, you go through a stream of stringent conditionalities until you reach a certain decision point where you will say you now qualify for debt cancellation and then you cancel portions of your debt. Some research has shown that in some instances, certain countries have their debt reduced. But in some instances, some countries have ended up in more debt than what they were or than they had before they entered the EPIC, because you will not qualify unless and until you check and almost clear your arrears. You must pay something for you to be considered for the EPIC. The second one that the government is talking about is called resource pledging. Why resource pledging? It dates back to the discovery of diamond in 2006, the officialization of diamond mining in Zimbabwe. The thinking around that is that Zimbabwe cannot be considered a poor country because we have so much resources, so we can pledge the resources and say we'll repay, we'll clear our areas and we'll repay the debt using these resources. Okay, this is what the government is saying. Is that okay or not? It is not okay. Okay. For us as representatives, both proposals leading to what is called the hybrid strategy are not okay for us for the reason that I'll articulate below. For us as activists, we have a huge question that we want answered. We are saying that since Zimbabwe is going through a transition, there are many things that politically must be addressed. To answer the political question, I think there are atrocities. This is not a secret. There are atrocities that were committed by the independent regime after independence, and so many people lost their lives. And what many people are sort of like, the quest in many people's hearts and minds is to say the truth must be told. That is it's a political question that will always end on the Zimbabwe authorities, whether they address it today or not. The issue I'm talking about is that transitional justice that addresses issues around people community issues that also happened, human rights issues that happened after 2000. Now we are saying for that question to be complete, we must also answer the economic question. And for us, in as much as we are aware that there is a certain component of the debt, that the external debt that we have been able to assume as a colonial issue, we also understand that there was massive growth post-independence. And the argument that we're putting on the table is that